In this video, we derive an expression for the power delivered by a wave at a point on a string, and it's easy to get from there to expressions for maximum power and average power. Then at the end, we're going to work a quick example. So this video is part of a short sequence on the fundamentals of one-dimensional waves, and you can find a list of these videos in the description. To quickly review previous results, in the first video, we derived the mathematical form of a moving wave on a string. So there it is, and I want to point out that's a function of both position and time. So we write y of x and t, because at any given position along the string, you're going to have a point moving up and down with sinusoidal time dependence. And every point along the string is out of phase, so we have to have a function of both position and time to describe the motion of this wave. So the way it turned out was a cosine of kx minus omega t, where this is a rightward moving wave because of the minus sign. And to make a leftward moving wave, all you have to do is change that to a plus. And the A is the amplitude of the oscillations. Now the K gets a special name, that's called the wave number, and it's related to the wavelength by 2 pi over lambda. And the omega is the angular velocity, and that tells you the oscillation rate for a particular point on the string at a fixed value of x. That's related to period by 2 pi over t, which we can then turn into 2 pi times frequency. We also showed in this video that the wave speed is given by omega divided by k. So then in the second video, we used that equation for the moving wave to derive the one-dimensional wave equation in terms of wave speed. And that's a second-order partial differential equation that looks like that. Del squared y del x squared is equal to 1 over v squared, del squared y del t squared. In other words, if we differentiate that wave function twice with respect to x, we get the same thing as if we differentiate it twice with respect to t and then multiply by 1 over v squared. Now finally, in the third video in this sequence, we used Newton's second law to derive the one-dimensional wave equation from first principles, and an important fact popped out of that derivation. That's where we discovered how to relate the wave speed to the physical parameters of the problem, in other words, the tension on the string and the linear density. So the wave speed is equal to the square root of the tension divided by the linear density, or t over mu. Now we need one more previous result from very early in first semester physics, and that's a cute formula for the power delivered by a force. So we need to do just a quick derivation here because this is going to be handy when we're deriving our power formula. So here's our context. We have a simple cart moving with a horizontal velocity of v moving to the right, and a force of F pointing exactly to the right is applied to this cart, and we're trying to figure out the power output of this force. So what we do is we imagine a small amount of time dt going by, and in that amount of time, the cart is going to slide through a distance of dx, and some amount of work is going to be done on it, and we call that dw. So the incremental amount of work done as we go through that infinitesimal sliding distance of dx is given by F times dx. Now to be perfectly complete, really what we're talking about here is a dot product between the force and the dx vector. But in the particular situation we're looking at, the displacement points exactly in the same direction as the force, so the dot product is trivial, and we just get the product of the two magnitudes there. So I'm just going to write for now that that's f dx. So now what we do is divide both sides of this equation by dt, and we find that the rate at which work is done, that's dw dt, is equal to F times the rate of displacement dx over dt. Of course, that's just the velocity. So we end up with F times V. Now that thing on the left side, the rate at which work is done, that's called power. So we arrive at this cute formula, power equals force times velocity. That's how we're going to use it in our derivation today. But if you want to be more general about it, the angle between the force vector and the velocity vector does matter if they happen to not be aligned with each other. You still have a factor of cosine theta floating around, and we take care of that by calling this a dot product. So that completes the set of prior results that we're going to need for our derivation of the power delivered by a one-dimensional wave, and we're ready to dive in here. So let's freeze our animation at just some arbitrary moment in time. So now we're going to highlight the area that we're interested in, and we'll just blow that up. And we're looking at this point of interest on the string. And that's a little chunk of mass on the string that happens to be moving upward at the moment. I can tell it's moving upward because as this wave continues to move to the right, I can see that the y coordinates are going to increase as this part of the wave ends up moving into the region of interest. Now we're interested in the power delivered to this point as the wave arrives from the left. So the force on this little chunk of mass exerted from the left side of it is the only part that we actually care about. And that's a tension of T. And this tension vector can be broken into X and Y components in the usual way. We're going to call those TY and TX. And now we're ready to calculate the power delivered at this point. So we start with our little power formula in terms of force and velocity. And remember, that's actually a dot product. In other words, we can just look at the component of the force on this little mass, pointing in the same direction as the velocity. So the power is going to be TY times V. And we may as well plug it in right now. V is just the time partial derivative of our wave function y of xt. So I end up with ty times del y del t. So now we want to relate ty to the slope of the string. So I notice that the slope of the string is a negative number here, but the steepness is given by ty divided by tx if we consider those to just be magnitudes of the tension. So the slope of the string, that's the x partial of the wave function, so it's del y del x. And that has a steepness of ty divided by tx, but I know it has to be negative, so I have a minus sign out in front. This allows me to solve for ty, and I get negative tx del y del x. So we'll sub that in just a second, but there's one more trick that we have to do. We have to use a small amplitude approximation. And this is similar to what we had to do in the previous video where we were using Newton's second law to derive the wave equation. So this is a pretty realistic assumption for most waves. I'm thinking about like a wave on a guitar string. You don't see the string flopping all over like what we see in this picture. The vibrations are barely perceptible to the eye because the amplitude is so small. Now what this does for us mathematically is we're allowed to say in this force decomposition here that the angle is so flat that the hypotenuse of this triangle is going to be approximately equal to just tx, which is the horizontal side of it. So provided the amplitude is small, we can just replace tx with the tension in the string. All right, so we're going to replace ty with this expression. We're going to replace the tx in it with a simple t. And now I get this formula for the power. The power is going to be negative t del y del x times del y del t, where y is the wave function of this moving wave. So just a quick reminder, that's a cosine kx minus omega t. So now we just have to take the x partial and the t partial of this wave function. So the partial of y with respect to x just means we hold t constant and we take the x derivative of this function. When I do that, I get a minus sign from differentiating the cosine function and I get a k from the chain rule. So I end up with a negative ak sine kx minus omega t. Now the t partial, del y del t, I take the derivative again of the cosine function, giving me a negative sine function, but this time the chain rule gives me a negative omega, which cancels that minus sign. So I end up with an a omega and the same trig function here, sine of kx minus omega t. So now we're going to get the power delivered as a function of position and time. This is also a function of two variables. I sub these two partial derivatives in to my power formula that I derived, and we're going to move all the constants out in front. So notice with a minus sign out in front here, and then a minus sign out in front of the x partial derivative, I end up with a plus sign out in front. And I can write this as a squared t k omega sine squared kx minus omega t. So that's our answer, but it's common to eliminate the wave number from it here. So just a little reminder, v is omega over k. That means we can replace the wave number k with omega over v. So getting that part done, I have an a squared t times omega over v. So I end up with an omega squared over v times this same trig function, sine squared kx minus omega t. And then I remember that V can be replaced in terms of the physical parameters of the system here. That's the square root of T over mu. So dividing by that in my power expression is the same as multiplying by the square root of mu over T. And when I multiply that through by the T, let me just bring the omega squared out in front real quick. When I multiply square root mu over T times T, I end up with a square root mu T. So that's our final expression for the power as a function of position and time along this string. And the way I wrote it here when I typeset it, I simply moved the square root of mu t out in front of the expression. All right, that's the main goal of the video, but there's a little bit more to do. First, I want to point out that just by staring at this formula, we see a couple interesting relationships. First, the power delivered by a wave is proportional to the square of the amplitude. And that one is really important because we're going to see that with sound waves and even light waves. Secondly, we notice that the power is proportional to the square of the angular frequency, which means it's also proportional to the square of the ordinary frequency. And third, knowing that the maximum value of the sine function is 1, we can just observe what the maximum power is for any moment in time and space. So the maximum power delivered is going to be square root mu t times a squared omega squared, just the coefficient of the sine squared piece there. Now the final thing we want to do is derive an expression for the average power if we average over a long period of time. And I'm going to just give away the answer here. I remember that the average value of the square of a sine or a cosine is just 1/2. And that means the average power delivered to any location along the string is going to be 1/2 root mu t a squared omega squared. All right, but I'm going to include the derivation of that average value for those of you who haven't seen it before. So recall what we mean by the average value of a function on an interval is that we're going to integrate the function on that interval and then divide by the interval width. And geometrically, what that means is what's the constant function that bounds the same amount of area as the function we're studying on that interval. So when we talk about the average value of this power function, we really mean what's the long run average if we take a super big time interval. But for a periodic function, that's the exact same thing as the average value over one period or two periods or any number of integer periods. So keeping x constant and just looking at a time average, the period of a sine function here is just going to be 2 pi divided by the coefficient of t, so 2 pi divided by omega. Now, as it turns out, the period of a sine squared is 1/2 that, but it's okay. We can average over two periods if it's conceptually simpler, because the average over two periods is the same as the average over one period for a periodic function. So what we're going to do is average on the interval 0 to 2 pi over omega, and that's going to be the same thing as the long run average of this function. By the way, we're going to see this again when we get to alternating current circuits. So to find p bar, I said it before, but now I'll write it. We take 1 divided by the interval width. So we're averaging as t goes from 0 to 2 pi over omega. And then we integrate the function on that same interval. And again, this is a t integral, and we're keeping x fixed. So we can move all the constants out in front. And I'm going to go ahead and deal with the complex fraction while I'm at it. So we get square root mu t, a squared omega cubed, all divided by 2 pi. And then we're integrating a sine squared, which is a classic trigonometric integral from second semester calculus. When you have a sine squared, there's basically only one way out of this problem. I have to use a trig identity. And what I'm going to do is replace sine squared with 1/2 times the quantity 1 minus cosine of twice the argument. Again, there's a 1/2 in front of that identity, so I can absorb that in the constants out in front. I get square root mu t, a squared omega squared over 4 pi, and then I'm integrating on 0 to 2 pi over omega, a 1 minus cosine of twice this angle. So I end up with 1 minus cosine of 2kx minus 2 omega t. Now I can go ahead and guess the antiderivative. So the 1 integrates to a t. And then my cosine function integrates to a sine function with the same argument. But I also have a negative 1 over 2 omega out in front to account for the chain rule. So I have a plus 1 over 2 omega, sine of 2kx minus 2 omega t. And we're evaluating all this from 0 to 2 pi divided by omega. So when I evaluate across the limits of integration, I have that first piece, the t piece, which is going to give me a 2 pi over omega. And when I subtract the lower limit, well, the lower limit just gives me 0. So there's that piece. Now we have to deal with the trig piece. And notice that when I sub this in for t, I end up with a sine of 2kx minus 4 pi. When I sub in the lower limit, I end up with a sine of 2kx. But I know the sine function is periodic with a period of 2 pi. So if I have the sine of 2kx and the sine of 2kx minus 4 pi, those two things are going to be exactly equal. And when I subtract them, I get zero. So this piece is gone. And I've simplified to just a 2 pi over omega in that part of the expression. Now I just noticed I changed my omega cubed into an omega squared for no reason at all. So we're gonna go back and fix all those. So I have omega cubed. One of those is gonna cancel. A pi is gonna cancel. And a 2 is gonna cancel. And I end up with a result of 1/2 square root of mu times t a squared omega squared. And that's precisely 1/2 the maximum power. Again, it's probably handy in the long run to just remember that the average value of a square of a sine or a square of a cosine is going to be 1/2, but that's how you prove it. So now we're just going to wrap things up with a simple example of applying this average power formula. So we're told we have waves traveling on a string with linear density 4.5 grams per meter and a tension of 35 newtons with a given amplitude of 0.5 cm and a given frequency of 200 hertz. And we want to find the average power input required to generate this wave. So that's an interesting trick. We've been talking about power delivered to a point this whole time, but it has to come from somewhere. So how much power do you have to put into the wave for it to be delivering that power somewhere down the line? So we're really just using our new average power formula. And that's going to be a 1/2, again, from averaging the square of a trig function times the square root of mu t times a squared omega squared. And now we just have to figure out all the parts to put into this formula. We need to get things in the right units. So we'll just start with the linear density here. We were given 4.5 grams per meter that needs to be changed into SI base units. So that's 0.0045 kilograms per meter. Our tension was given to us as 35 newtons, so that's no problem. Our amplitude was given to us in centimeters, so we better change to meters. That's 0.005 meters. And we need to get that frequency turned into an angular frequency. So remember, omega is going to be 2 pi times the frequency. Frequency gives you oscillations per second. Angular frequency gives you radians per second. So it's a factor of 2 pi to get those radians per second. So I have a 2 pi f. That's 2 pi times 200 hertz. Maybe we'll just leave it in that form and plug it in before we use our calculator. So I sub in all the numbers here, and I have that the average power is 1/2 times the square root of mu times t, so 0.0045 times 35, times the amplitude squared, so I have a 0.005 squared, times the angular frequency squared. And that's 2 pi times 200, so I'm just going to call that 400 pi. And when I run the numbers on this to three significant digits, I get 7.83 watts. And we're done.
If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.